My name is Suhir Mzali, and I am the regional editor for Africa at Oxford Business Group. And I am glad to be joined today by Khaldoun Barsida, Managing Director and Country Cluster Head for Northwest Africa at BASF. Khaldoun, welcome and thank you very much for your involvement with OBG's Africa CEO survey.
Welcome, Suhir, and thanks a lot for inviting me.
So we're here today to discuss some of the results of our most recent survey that we conducted at the end of April with African CEOs in the various markets we cover. And one of the first conclusions we were able to draw from this survey is that just like everywhere else around the world, business has also been disrupted in Africa. So I'm just going to pull out this first graph to illustrate what we are currently going to talk about. There we go. So as you can see here, we have the largest majority of respondents saying their businesses are operating at less than 60% capacity, with the most affected sectors being tourism and construction. Khaldoun, yourself being based in the region as we speak, what is your take on how this pandemic has affected business in Africa? And at the same time, what do you think of how most countries have responded to this crisis?
Thanks a lot again, Suhir. Yeah, I mean, North Africa reacted very quick, being close to Spain and Italy, where the pandemic was quite alarming. And of course, the northern part of Africa has a very, very strong dynamic into the tourism sector. So tourism is quite important. So it's really something we see on this chart that tourism was heavily impacted. The construction sector as well, because construction is driver in countries like Egypt and Algeria, Morocco. It is known that this is a very sensitive sector of activity in Africa. So I think this picture reflects the reality, and a lot of countries decided to help and to boost, but I think it's not yet there because they need the funds, and now they are distributing the support to such a small company.
Now, we all know that this crisis has caused huge disruptions around the world to supply chains, generally speaking. And one of the areas we looked at in the survey are industrial supply chains. Now, this is likely to be a bigger issue for the sub-region than it is for North Africa, where countries such as Tunisia and Morocco have invested heavily in their industrial bases for decades now. That said, that doesn't exclude the fact that the Maghreb region is also affected by these disruptions. So to what extent do you think this will lead to more development and investment in local African industry, Khaldoun? And how can Africa address some of the issues that have traditionally challenged the efficiency of supply chains in the region?
Yeah, it is a game changer. This pandemic is a game changer. So a lot of countries will be more and more conservative. That means they will prefer not importing but producing themselves. The disruption of the supply chain, especially from China, I mean, we shouldn't forget that January and Feb, the disruption came from China. We couldn't have material from China. So a lot of them find a way to buy and to outsource locally, which is very good because at least the dynamic stays in the same country. But then African countries, it's not the first time that they have such problems. They do have other problems like drought, like floods, like civil wars. So they are resilient. The resilience is there. So the youth is there. And I think this will be an opportunity for a lot of countries to rebound and to really be self-sufficient. This is the note of optimism I see from this pandemic.
Now, moving on to the topic of agriculture, Most of those surveyed are expecting disruptions in agriculture in their countries. With this being more of a problem, as we can see in this graph, in Nigeria and Côte d'Ivoire. What's your interpretation of this, Khaldoun, and how can Africa work on establishing a more resilient agricultural sector moving forward?
For Nigeria, it is expected because Nigeria was already a problem for importing goods. Firstly, there is no the currency is not available, foreign currency, and secondly, Côte d'Ivoire was putting a lot of efforts in the cocoa, so the cocoa sector is not working properly nowadays. So they cannot export. I think for North Africa, the problem is less because North Africa is exporting even more to Italy and Spain. The East Coast of Africa suffered a lot also from drought and from even floods in Tanzania. So it has nothing to do with the pandemic as such, because Africa agriculture is dynamic every year. What we can say is the value chain in the food industry will suffer a lot. That means the food processing, the export, and of course the creation of jobs. And this is a problem. Mm-hmm.
Absolutely. Now, we at Oxford Business Group have been reporting on many of the developments across all sectors in the markets we cover. And what I have been quite impressed by in Africa is that a lot of these solutions are actually homegrown solutions that have been developed by African entrepreneurs. Looking at the next graph, we see that almost half of the businesses we surveyed are currently investing in innovative tech solutions to keep businesses running smoothly, with Tunisia ranking at the very top of that list. What is your perception of how tech-driven solutions have helped Africa during this pandemic, and with the potential these have to generate growth and employment, what needs to be done to ensure Africa is able to leverage such solutions and skills?
Very valid point. I mean, Africa was already a pioneer and in the e-commerce. I mean, if you see Rwanda, and if you see Kenya especially, this is not new for Africa. What is new here is that they are forced to use now more and more digital tools to run more technologies and to go for simplification. I mean, before in Africa, maybe the ruler or the authorities was reluctant for implementing such tools. But now it's a unique opportunity for the youth and for the startups to show that it works. They started with solutions how to eradicate this pandemic catastrophe first. I mean, how to track people that have the disease, clusters, and things like this. But then you have the e-payment, you have retail is booming in many countries, online, of course. I see it as an opportunity now to really implement more and more technological tools and more digital solutions.
Absolutely, Khaldoun, and technology and innovation are definitely going to be important enablers in helping countries evolve and even more so diversify economies in the aftermath of this pandemic.
Yes.
And unfortunately, this crisis came at a time where many African countries have economic diversification agendas in place, and some are well underway, but there is still a lot of work to do to get African countries to shift away from depending too much, for example, on commodities. Talking of commodities, we're expecting oil producing countries in particular to be some of the hardest hit economically on the back of the recent fall in oil prices. And I'll just pull out this graph now that shows some of the countries that where businesses are most concerned by this issue. What is your take on this, Khaldun?
It's a twofold. Firstly, there will be no investment because the oil price is down. That means there is no resources, especially Algeria and Nigeria. Secondly, there will be no hard currency. The problem will be hard currency for a huge country like Nigeria. Importing goods will not be easy at all. And you see that here there is a link between the oil price, the currency, and the topic we discussed earlier, the food and supply. I mean, you cannot import if you don't have currencies. But this is really a Nigerian topic. Regarding Algeria, they don't suffer not only from the oil price, but also from the output of gas, because Algeria is exporting gas through three pipelines to Italy and to Spain as major off-takers. And those two major off-takers are now slowing down. So for Algeria is a double effect, oil, but also gas. What I do see is a slow recovery starting September, because as soon as Europe restarts producing more and more, then I think there will be less pressure in this case. And I'm quite confident that till September, we will see a nice horizon.
Mm-hmm. And just to bounce back on what you said about Nigeria and food, indeed, in our survey, we actually asked, you know, how people see food imports evolving in the next 2 to 3 months. And all the countries we surveyed said they see food imports declining, whereas Nigeria was the only country amongst those that we surveyed that said food imports are actually going to increase. What's your take on that, Khaldun?
This is a direct link again with the oil price and with the availability of hard currency for Nigeria. So if there is no hard currency, food import will be very difficult. And there are also measures from food exporting countries like Russia or Ukraine that don't want to export food anymore because they fear that they will have problems within their own countries. So it's double fold. It is exporters that are conservative. They want to be paid cash, yeah, because of the crisis. So the credit limits are not that sufficient anymore, but also the availability of hard currency. So for Nigeria, it's really a worst case scenario.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And just one last question before we wrap up this discussion. We've seen a big response coming from Africa's private sector during this pandemic. Could you perhaps tell us how BASF has been doing in the wake of all of this, how the company has responded, and how you envisage back to business in your industry?
Oh, thanks a lot. So we are a diversified company. So we have some, of course, slowdown in the automotive sector, but in the agro, the food processing, food feed, and especially everything that is related to home care, disinfection, and to cosmetics as well. This is quite okay. The pandemic is, of course, quite demanding in terms of logistics, but our sites from Europe were really present. And we are really trying to help as much as we can our customers because we are adding value in those countries. That means jobs are behind it. So if our customers are stopping, there will be a socio-economic effect that is worse than selling chemicals, which is having unemployment. So I think we are doing our homework properly. We are working hand in hand with chemical federations as well and agro federations to tackle as much problems as we can.
And with that, we come to the end of this discussion. Khaldun, thank you very much for your time and for your involvement in this OBG Africa CEO survey.
Thanks a lot, and hope to see you soon.